welcome to the Zelda Informer podcast. I am your host, Nathaniel Ruffeljantz, joined again after a little break due to some technical difficulties by our co-host, Alfred.
Hello.
And this week, for the first time, although it feels like the fifth time because he's been trying every week.
Third time's a charm, baby. Third time's a charm.
One of our writers at the site, Mr. Kristen.
Hello. Glad to finally be here.
It's so weird for me to say your name, too, because my mom's name is Kristen, so it's like...
Ah, oh, man, sorry to hear that.
Anyways, obviously I just call her Mother, so I don't have to worry about it too much. We got a jam-packed podcast for today, including, towards the end of the cast, we have the results from our E3 betting, so that's... You guys are going to want to tune in for that, because there's going to be some high debates going on who won. This will be fun. But let's just get right into the main reason most of you guys are here. Because, I mean, come on, who cares about some personal bets until you actually see the punishment?
True. Very true.
Oh,
I care.
The punishments. The punishments. Of course we care.
Yeah. I'm curious.
All right, so we're going to get right into our first segment here. So we have a whole bunch of topics for this week because there's a whole bunch of news. Obviously, we're going to continue to get a bunch of news for Breath of the Wild. But we're not just going to be talking about Breath of the Wild today. I know, shocker.
Wow.
But we're going to get right into our first topic, and I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on this topic because I know how touchy it gets for people. But it is something I wanted to go over just because it, you know, all this news kind of hit in the last week with all the interviews and everything hitting online. So this one, the first topic is basically that Link is always going to be the hero of the main games. Let me go over the exact quote here. This comes from the series creator, Shigeru Miyamoto. He says, "We clearly talked with the team to make a game centered about Sheik, so I cannot say it is impossible to see something of the sort in the future. But in the classic games in the series, Link is the hero, and that will not change. For the rest, you have to be patient and see what happens." And then earlier in the week, Ijeonomo kind of had this to say when talking about having like a gender option or like a female character playable in Zelda. Said that Linkle was something that the game producer for Hyrule Warriors, Yosuke Hayashi from Koei Tecmo, wanted to include in that game. "And we thought for a game like that, where you're constantly switching characters, it might work. But for the type of Zelda that we're making, the fact that there is a Princess Zelda and a Link, we don't just think that is quite right. A few years ago, I mentioned that it might not be Link in a trailer, and it kind of caught fire, and people started to think that it may be a female Link. But that's definitely not what I had in mind. I was very surprised, and I should be careful what I say." All right. A lot to digest. But the general gist of it is that Link, as a character, is male. Link is always going to star in the main games. There's not going to be like an option to play as somebody else outside of... I'm sure, like, the short portions of the game, like, you know, in Majora's Mask, you have to play as Kaffee, I think, for a little bit. So there might always be portions of the game like that. But in general, you're not constantly switching characters, as he said. So you're going to be playing as Link. And that there obviously won't be a gender option for him or a female character option. So, obviously, this has been a huge topic of debate at Zelda Informer. Pretty much since Darren dropped the big bomb editorial. And got the whole world mad at him. And it's not like I made things better by posting a certain comic. But obviously, this has been a huge topic of debate. And it seems like it's kind of put to bed now. There's almost no reason to even hold the conversation, I think, at this point. Because now we've heard from the two people, the creator of Zelda, and the person who is the lead producer of all Zelda games. That, yeah, it's not going to happen. Link is it. And he's been it for 30 years, and he's going to keep being it. At least as long as these two are alive and have a say. You guys have any thoughts on that? I don't even know where you guys stood on that whole debate.
Well, it sucks we're not going to get Wanda Gamelon too, but other than that, you know, it's fine. You know, Zelda is going to be there, of course, but there's... I think there's going to be a point like in certain other games have this to where like it's like the final game or a big blockbuster game where I'll have a small story segments where you play a different character just for a teen spit like you brought up. So I think probably not this game, Breath of the Wild, but maybe a future Zelda game that'll happen. I am curious.
Yeah, see, I don't know if they're even going to do that again.
Yeah.
And I only say that because, and this kind of leads into the what the second topic is going to be, so I don't want to get into it quite yet. But Shigeru Miyamoto did mention specifically that there could be some side games where Link isn't the hero.
Yeah. Isn't that where Sheik...
He brought up an example himself, you know, a game centered around Sheik, you know, and having Sheik be the star.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind playing a Sheik game. That'd be really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, that's why I, you know, what they did in Majora's Mask was very unusual because they haven't, I don't know if they've even done that in any of the other games where you play as another character. Unless you want to count, like, controlling the Phantom in Spirit Tracks. That, to me, that was more like an item use.
Yeah, well, like, I wouldn't really consider Kafka a side character in Majora's Mask either that you play as because it's not for, like, a significant portion of the game.
Well, yeah. It's just like a little side quest thing that you do.
So at that point,
I mean, it was really interesting and cool, but you know, it wasn't.
Well, at that point, it's basically like controlling the Phantom. Like, there's it's not that important. I mean, not to say that side quest isn't important; it's one of the bigger ones in the game. But that's not like a oh my gosh,
that
we're playing
portion
with someone
of the
else.
Quest isn't,
no,
yeah.
isn't
like a huge deal.
Yeah. I really think that down the road there is going to be a game where Link's not the main hero because it's going to get to a point where people would like something a little different, you know. Like, you know, they've tried that once in a while, but they never really truly tried it without Link. You know, I would love to play something like a Sheik game, because when I think the Sheik game, automatically I'm thinking of is like a stealth action game, right off the bat, you know? And that gets me really excited to play something like that.
Yeah. Now, you know, I on the side of the people that, because there's a lot of people upset about this, and... It always strikes me odd that they're upset about it since, I mean, they haven't been upset about it for 30 years. So suddenly you're upset about it, nothing's changed, I guess. I will say that, in their defense, that some of the early excuses given towards the beginning of, like, the first day of E3 were pretty bad. Like, there was one about how, like, the balance of the Triforce would be off because, you know, there's a princess. And there's Ganondorf and Link, so, like, if they had a female Link or a female character, it would throw the balance off for some reason. I thought that was a weird excuse, because I don't remember the balance ever being based off gender. So that was really weird. Plus, like, how many times did they replace Ganon in the game and had a different enemy? Like, it was just a really bad excuse. It felt like they were just pulling something out of their butt.
I mean, the main reason people are getting heat over this is that nowadays people like to debate over gender equality in different things. Movies, television, games. I mean, now that, you know, the producer and the creator are being more open about, you know, not being there being a female Link, now people are getting more of an uproar nowadays because nowadays you have to have an opinion regarding gender equality. That's how the internet wants you to be.
And to be fair, I know that, you know, gender equality has a big encompassing thing, but there is a problem with it in the gaming industry.
Yeah, definitely, definitely.
You know, especially, like, in the development realm, it's really bad. Females are, from all the stories I've seen, it's all horror stories. Like, unless a girl runs her own company or is really high up in the company, they're treated really bad. And even, like, obviously I don't have a lot of one-on-one experience in terms of seeing that in studios myself. But I could say things like, even when I went to E3 this year, I was there, and, you know, it was about 85% males in terms of the media and, you know, all the attendees. So it was already mostly a male-dominated thing. A lot of the booths, including Nintendo's, included basically showgirls. They're there to look pretty. You know, Link, I posted a thing on Twitter, but this is the closest you get to a female Link. Well, Nintendo had models of, you know, women all over their booth wearing Link's attire, even though Link is not female. And obviously, that's, you know, recognizing the crowd. It's 85% males.
When I first started watching, like, earlier E3s on television or so sneak peeks of it, it used to be, I know for a fact, it used to be a lot worse when it came to, like, what they called booth babes, you know? It was a lot worse.
They've definitely toned down. you know, Nintendo's booth, obviously no one was wearing anything that was overly sexualized, so it wasn't a big deal. You know, it was just cosplaying Link. Like, okay, cool. But there was a lot of, some of the other booths had some scantily clad women. So, you know, it's a problem. And I understand that, you know, E3 is a bad barometer because it encompasses video game media, which I think is only recently, maybe in like the last 5 years, really starting inviting females into that environment and letting them become big names and covering things and not just be showgirls on a video. Because, yeah, you know, it's true. You know, if you watch a lot of, like, even at IGN or GameSpot, like, if you see a woman on, you know, a video cast for them, it's someone who's pretty good looking.
Yeah.
And that's on purpose because they know their audience. And that sucks. I'm not saying that good-looking women can't be in the industry and they can't be passionate about games and be on camera. Of course they can. Like, that's nothing against that. But it's kind of showing, you know, the leaning of all the media towards serving what kind of online, unfortunately, is primarily a male audience. And I think that's where this whole gender equality comes up. And how Zelda got roped into all of it is really... I mean, Adrian Noble here admits, you know, that it's kind of his fault because he said something... you know, that inferred that it wasn't Link, so people thought, oh, it's a female Link or something. Like, it's really weird how they inferred it was a female Link when he said that that might not be Link.
Yeah, then, like, later...
Like, he literally said, you know, it might not... I didn't explicitly say that was Link. Okay. So, like, somehow, and we were part of that problem, it got twisted into, like, oh, he didn't say it's Link, so it's a female. No, he literally said that it might not be Link at all. Like, not like a female version, like, it might not even be that character.
Yeah, that wasn't until later.
And he clarified that same E3, too. It was, like, 2 days later, he was like, oh, I didn't mean, like, gender option stuff. I meant that, like, people shouldn't be so attached to how Link looks. And obviously, that was alluding to what we have in Breath of the Wild, which is, you know, all the clothing options and, you know, the ponytail and, you know, doing things differently and breaking conventions of how Link looks.
Yeah, that's where he brought up that comment about, you know, yeah.
So that's what he actually meant.
Link looks androgynous in this. He had to bring that comment up. Otherwise, people would still constantly be getting on his case about it.
Well, yeah. Especially with the weak excuses he originally gave. Because, I think everyone can accept the fact that if it's like, look, we created Link as a male character. He's always going to be a male character. If they had just said that no one would probably throw a fit about it. Because what are you supposed to say? Like, he's always been male. You know, why change it now? Just because he has multiple iterations? Like, it doesn't matter. You know, if that's what they want to do, that's what they're going to do.
I think that the big thing here is... for me, The Legend of Zelda is kind of like it's an established series. Like, we can all recognize that it's been the way it has been for years. And to assume that because of the shift in time, like, of how our culture is going, that the game needs to follow that culture shift is an incorrect notion. Because look at games like Uncharted, or look at games like Halo, where the character is male. Like, Master Chief is a guy. Nathan Drake is a guy, and while there are some supporting female characters, primarily the characters are men. And that's not necessarily a problem because that's reflective of, the audience that it had. However, if you're looking at now, like watching E3, two games come to mind immediately showing, like, bringing in strong female protagonists.
Yep.
And we have Tomb Raider, the new Tomb Raider series, which is a less sexualized version of Lara Croft than we had back in the 90s.
Yeah, I mean, still attractive, but, like, not... more realistic, I'd say.
Yeah, and then we have...
someone who would actually be doing that.
Yeah, and then we have Horizon Zero Dawn, which is another strong female protagonist in a game. And I think that if Nintendo wanted to do a game featuring a strong female protagonist that's not Metroid, because who knows what they're doing with that game right now, I don't think it would be in their best interest to take an already established IP and build off of that. I think it would be in their best interest to go ahead and create an entirely new one, because that's what Sony's doing with these new franchises, or that's what whoever's in charge of Tomb Raider's doing.
I was always indifferent on this because I don't really care if there was gender options or multiple playable characters. Like, I don't really... to be honest, I don't really play Zelda games because of Link. He just happens to be the character I'm given control of, but mm-hmm. he really isn't why I play. Like, yeah, I've gotten into the lore, and it's interesting, but a lot of the lore had, I mean, surprisingly so far, has had little to do with Link. It's just a hero saved the day. A hero could be anyone. Obviously, we know it's Link, but Link really hasn't had a personality or anything for me to really care too much about. Compared to, like, say, even the lead guy from Mass Effect in the
trilogy. Oh, yeah, Shepard. Yeah.
Shepard. Shepard. Like, he had more of a personality than Link did. So, like, I care about Shepard, and, like, I understand that, you know, with the new Mass Effect game, they're not going to have Shepard, and that makes sense. They wrapped up his story. Like, move on.
Yeah, I agree with your point on that. I really don't care what gender I play in a video game. All that matters to me is I'm playing the video game. That's all that matters. Yeah. Like, even...
Yeah, so I didn't care about that. I just thought, like... never really finished making my point. I'm trying to remember what I was trying to say. Basically, it's that they took Zelda and somehow put it on this pedestal, and partially, you know, Eiji Inoue admitted partially his fault, where they expected all this stuff from him, wanted stuff from him. There's rumors saying it was going to happen, and reality is that Zelda is a series that's been very respectful to women. Women are actually a bigger deal in this series than men are. I made this as a joking comment to someone one time, but if you want to talk about sexism in Zelda, it's almost slanted towards the men, because men are always the bad guys. Always. It's always a male character that's
well,
bad.
Then most of the sages in Ocarina of Time were women, too.
They were strong. Most of the sages, all the goddesses, we don't hear about gods, we hear about goddesses.
Yeah,
exactly.
Like, all the most powerful people out there are female, and the bad guy's always male. Yes, you know, the counterbalance, you know, and maybe this is what Nintendo was trying to say with the Triforce. The counterbalance to there being a strong male enemy and all these powerful women is to have a playable male hero. Like, I can understand maybe if that was the viewpoint they were going for, and they just conveyed it really, really bad, really bad.
Yeah, the closest they ever got to a female villain in a Zelda game was Hyrule Warriors, but that isn't really non-canon, A. And B, even if it was, she's only the main villain of the story for
spoiler
like half...
Spoiler alert.
Spoiler alert. Sorry, I apologize.
But you don't have to spoil it. The game's like 2 years old now. Don't worry about it.
So, like, the first half is just Sia as a villain. And you think, okay, that's over. She's a villain. We defeat her. No, Ganon's still the villain, main guy.
And if you paid any attention, you knew ahead of time that Ganon was the villain, because Ganon was confirmed to be playable before the game released.
Yeah. Yeah, so, an example of, like, you know, there was...
Sia was just, like, a Ghirahim, just a pawn.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that...
No, go on. That's it?
Oh, yeah, that's it. Sorry.
That's it. No, it's cool. Like, I don't know. I always felt, you know, again, it's Eiji Inoue's fault. If he had never made those remarks, because I don't remember this really ever. I've been covering Zelda for 18 years. I don't remember this being talked about at all in regards to Zelda until Eiji Inoue made those remarks. There were some people that commented, you know, when the game was first shown off in 2014, that, oh, Link looks a little feminine-ish. But that was it. That was as far as the conversation went. No one actually thought it was a female Link. And then he had to say what he said, and everything blew up since then. Obviously, we had, you know, untrue rumors and all that stuff. So, I think we spent way more time talking about this than I wanted to, because this is a huge topic. It's not just about Zelda, why people are upset.
And also, hasn't there been other Zelda games where Link has kind of looked a little bit more feminine? I mean, why haven't those
been... Skyward Sword.
He's always been a pretty boy.
Yeah. Skyward Sword's the most notable one about that. Like, yeah. I'd be playing in my at college, and someone would come and be like, hey, Link looks a little like a girl. I was like, yeah, you know, that...
I've always, like... If you look at all the official art, and then, you know, it always looked to me, Link's a pretty boy. And pretty boys, as they kind of said, you know, in talking about the gender-neutral appearance of Link, it's a way to appeal to all genders, because tomboys can look like pretty boys, and men can look like pretty boys. Like, it's kind of a thing that covers both genders. But, canonically, Link is male. And apparently that's probably the way it's always going to be, unless somebody else takes over the series and decides to change all that, which... You know, Nintendo would never retcon their own quotes. Yeah. I mean, they totally do it all the time.
And that's not a bad thing.
As long as these two are running the series, this is the way it's going to be. And I don't see a problem with that. Mm-hmm. In fact, there's so much good stuff with Breath of the Wild that we should probably just move on from this topic.
Yeah.
I know our fans are sick of talking about it. I'm sick of talking about it. It's put to bed. Thank you, Miyamoto and Inoue, for, like, finally putting a nail in it. Be like, look, keep talking about it all you want. It's not happening. End of story.
Sorry, Tumblr.
According to comments from this podcast, are going to be about
Gender. We briefly talked about spin-off games, you know, how, like, that Sheik game that Miyamoto was pressing for, you know, would be really cool as a side game. You know, I just want to talk about this for a couple minutes, about the side games, because this next topic I really want to make sure we get to. You know, side games, we've had Hyrule Warriors, we've had Link's Crossbow Training in the past. A lot of people think Triforce Heroes is a side game, but it is not technically a side game. It is part of the mainline series.
Yeah, isn't it like a sequel to the Link Between Worlds story?
Yes. Yes, it is.
Yeah.
So, it, you know, that's all fine and dandy. Like, whatever people want to think about the game is what they want to think. We can get to that game in a little bit here. But I am very interested in the idea of Nintendo expanding the Zelda universe and having more side games for their side characters.
Yeah.
You know, showing what happened, that, you know, like a Sheik game, I would assume that would show what happened in the 7 years in Ocarina of Time. That would be really cool.
Yeah.
And that would still fit in the timeline. It just wouldn't be considered a main game. I mean, maybe it's not as long. Maybe it's a $40 game instead of a $60 game.
Yeah.
Or what have you. But, you know, it's just like a little side venture where, you know, they have a small team just, you know, exploring all this stuff, you know, based on, you know, whatever documentation they have of what happened. Using existing, you know, graphics and all the stuff they have, so it doesn't take as long to make. Like, it would be kind of cool if they did that to fill the gaps, I guess. If we're going to keep getting these 5-6 year gaps for main, like, home console games, like, it would be cool if they filled the gaps with these little side ventures.
Oh, yeah, I would love to play different other characters, pretty much. It would be really fun.
Yeah.
There's been enough unique characters in the Zelda universe that, you know, somebody could get their own side game and it would make complete sense.
Yeah. I think the biggest thing for that I think Nintendo's a little bit hesitant on is that there's no guarantee that the people that are playing the side game have played Ocarina of Time or played
any
of the other games. And so I kind of view it like, have you guys ever seen Cowboy Bebop or Space Dandy?
Cowboy Bebop,
So Watanabe, the creator, has always, like, his main thing with the show, with both shows, is that he wants each episode to kind of be its own separate thing to where you could jump in at any point in the series and understand what's going on. Like, you don't even have to know.
That's what Zelda's kind of
Like. And so, like, Zelda, aside from, I mean, unless you look at Majora's Mask and Phantom Hourglass, those are the only two really direct sequels, and even then you really don't 100% need to know what's going on in the series to know what's going on. And so I've always imagined that as being Zelda, and I think that might be why they're a little hesitant to kind of make a side game.
Yeah, I mean, the counter to that is just that these are side games. They're not mainline games. They don't have to work that way.
Well, but I mean, like, that's speaking specifically to the thought that Sheik in the 7 years.
Like, side games, obviously, they don't have the Legend of Zelda moniker attached to them, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, it would just be, like, whatever the subtitle. Like, let's say, you know, it's Sheik's Avengeance or, you know, Resurgence. Or
Revengeance.
Like, people aren't even going to know who Sheik is unless you play Ocarina of Time.
Yeah.
So they're not even going to be paying attention to that game unless they play that.
Do you think that Nintendo would have enough faith in that title to sell?
I think after this game, because this game right now, it clearly has a lot of base in, like the Sheikah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and a lot of lore is going to be in there. And I think there might be a lot of back references because of what happened to the Temple of Time, like some back references to Ocarina of Time that's going to make people really wonder what the heck Sheik was doing.
I can see it as like a Nintendo eShop game, you know, like with Xbox Live Arcade, just like what they do with the Assassin's Creed Chronicles games pretty much, where it was just a cheaper version. It was just a cheaper version game, same universe, different story. I can see Nintendo doing that where it's pretty much same. It's in the same realm. It's a bit cheaper than a full price Zelda game, but you'll still get the full experience with this character you're playing.
Sure, I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
So we have a lot more we can say on this topic. I'm gonna jot this actually down, doing it right now. As a reminder, bring this up a little, maybe in a future podcast, so we can have a longer conversation on it. And I'm saying that just because I have a couple really big topics here that I want to get into.
Okay.
Obviously, we're being slammed with news left and right. So one thing I really wanted to cover, though, because I have a lot to say on it, and I hope you guys do too, is game delays. Nintendo and Shigeru Miyamoto and Eiji Inoue finally opened up on why Zelda games seem to always get delayed. So I'm just going to go through all the quotes, and then I'll kind of go back and highlight one of the main things I want to talk about that really confuses me. So this comes from an interview. I forget who it's from. There'll be a link. We posted on our site. So first, Shigeru Miyamoto says, first of all, it would be great if I didn't have to put a release date out at all, but I have to. Then Eiji Nomu follows it up with, when we think about the release period for any Zelda game, we really want to get it out as soon as possible so that everybody can play and experience it. But every time we make a Zelda, we want to make something new. It's hard to gauge how long it's going to take. And it's also hard to gauge at what point whatever we consider to be new is done. A lot of times, when we try to tackle what we try to tackle takes a lot longer than anticipated. So that's why many times the development struggles there. It struggles and there is a delay. The people around us keep telling us, this is the last one, you really need to shape up. And then, let me see, Shigeru Miyamoto goes on, he has a long thing he says here. He says, I think there's different reasons for delays. One could be that the direction just hasn't been decided, which is probably the worst kind of delay. And the other is that the direction has been decided, but putting that into reality, implementing that, is taking time. So it might have taken us 6 months to do this much, but it ends up taking us a year to do that much. In terms of Breath of the Wild, we implemented many things like the physics engine and the AI and types of graphics that we use. We had to make sure that the design has enough time to create that. It just dawned on us that we were not able to do that in this schedule. That's what we realized about 2 years ago. In this instance, we never really experienced this, so that's why we had to delay it. Mr. Onoma and I had this understanding that this game should be done in this time frame, and he's in a tough position. He can't say that we can't do it. So I had someone else look into it, and they had to convince Mr. Onoma, and then they had to convince me to delay it. All right. So a couple big things in here. This might be, I'm probably not going to get to the fourth topic, which sucks. The fourth topic's really good, too. That's okay. That's what future podcasts are for, right?
exactly.
So a couple things I want to highlight. First of all, Shigeru Miyamoto is saying that he doesn't want to have to put a release date out, but for some reason he has to. To me, that's almost like an old mentality, because too often now games are just announced months before they come out. It's not a big deal. No one really thinks it's abnormal anymore. But for some reason with Zelda, they feel like they need that year and a half at least buffer to advertise it or something, which is really weird because it's a big franchise. It really doesn't need that. And then another thing that he says that I thought was interesting is that, for starters, game delays apparently are not decided by Mr. Eiji Onoma. Because he said in here, had understand that him and Mr. Miyamoto and Onoma had an understanding the game had to be done in enough time frame, which I'm assuming was originally 2015. And then he says he's in a tough position. He can't say that we can't do it. So literally, Eiji Onoma cannot go to Miyamoto and be like, sorry, we can't do it in this time frame. Which explains why in 2014, Eiji Onoma was very on point. This is coming out next year. This is coming out next year. Because apparently he doesn't get a say. That decision probably comes from Shigeru Miyamoto himself on if there can be a delay, based on what he said here. And even Miyamoto wasn't convinced that it couldn't be done. But apparently him and Onoma had a talk, so they brought in a third party who went and looked at how development was going, and then they convinced Mr. Onoma that, sorry, man, you're just not going to get this done in time. And then, on top of that, they had to go back to Miyamoto and be like, hey, look, like, this game needs extra time. And obviously, this seems to happen with every Zelda game, especially the console ones. So, I don't know. What are you guys' thoughts on it? It's really cool to get this insight, but I'm just confused on why they have to do things this way.
I think that it shouldn't be unexpected to have delays now. Like, I was reading not even an hour ago, the news drop today that Batman Return to Arkham got delayed indefinitely. Sorry for any of those who haven't played the game or are waiting.
Definite delays are some of the worst delays, by the way.
Well, and then we
that could be development hell. Yeah. That's bad.
That's equivalent to them saying, we'll tell you when we're ready.
That's basically, oh God, something bad happened.
And then we have...
We need to go back to the drawing board.
Well, then we have games like No Man's Sky who were they were announced years ago, and then they've been pushed back, and, you know, we're getting it sometime this summer, hopefully. Everybody's crossing their fingers for that. Talking about The Last Guardian, 9 years, 10 years, and it's finally getting released.
Final Fantasy 15, another example.
Like, all these games, like, not saying that they're right to be delayed, but we're at a point now where game developers kind of give us this ultimatum. It's like, well, would you rather have a delayed game that's finished, or would you rather have a broken game that came out and we had to patch it day one, day two, day three until it was working? And so.
My number nine. That's you just got brought up my what the what was it Inafune said about my number nine? It's better than nothing quote.
Well, I just think that it's like we're given this like stupid ultimatum. It's like, well, why can't you just like make the game correctly? And like I imagine it's a hard process. I'm not a game designer, but I've never been a
Yeah.
fan of like games that needed a patch. And I feel like I think I've talked about this before with someone else. I feel like game developers feel maybe not Nintendo, but game developers in general feel like they have a lot more leeway now that there's, you know, an internet that they can just stream a patch to. So the game doesn't necessarily have to be completely bug free, doesn't necessarily have to be completely done on day one, and they can just shove it out and say, oh, well, don't worry guys, day one patch, day two patch will have all the problems fixed. Because if you look back, like GameCube games, you know, unless you somehow had a LAN hookup and you were one of the few people that did, you still weren't going to get a patch for that game. That game came out and it was as is. So
Sure.
you had to be, and the games were, for the most part, finished, and there weren't a lot of glitches in them. Like Wind Waker was great. I don't think that there was, that didn't need to be any patching for that game. So I
That
don't.
game was rushed, though.
Yeah, I just don't
They
understand.
rushed it. They rushed it. They like wouldn't let it get delayed because they rushed it to make a deadline.
I just don't understand why, you know, we're given these two things. Like, well, okay, if you're pushing for this game to come out at X and you're like hyping everyone up for it, then if you need to shift teams that are working on other stuff here. And I think that the only reason why they didn't do that for Breath of the Wild is because they're frantically running around the office doing stuff for NX. And so we're seeing, like, of course we know that the delay to 2017 was for NX.
More clearly, yeah.
We're not stupid. We don't think it's, oh, we're polishing the game so that, you know, it'll be like better by 2017. I think for the most part the game is just about done, and we're just waiting for it because it's going to be a Wii U swan song NX launch title type thing.
Sure.
Polish is the video game equivalent of the term blast processing. It doesn't really mean anything. You know, it means something completely different. It's ridiculous how delays are nowadays with video games. Sometimes you get them, it's great, the wait was worth it. Other times, it gets to a point where it just pisses you off to where, like, no more. I've had friends just pissed at, like, Inafune for Mighty Number 9, and, like, they were just pissed by delays and then the outcoming product, and they're just like, screw this. And I agree.
Well, yeah. Well, what sucked about that particular case is they did delay it several times,
Yeah.
and it still turned out that way. That was what was so weird about it. It was like he released that game, you know, obviously before it was ready to be released, and the delays didn't feel justified because the game isn't done. So it and some of the best parts of the game are DLC for some reason.
I do miss a time where, you know, you could pop in a game, it sucked, and it sucked because the developers didn't know what the heck they were doing, you know.
Superman
You know,
64.
exactly. No, yeah, no. Nate brings a good Superman 64, you know. They clearly didn't know, you know, it was crap. We got to talk about it was crap. Imagine if Superman 64 nowadays, it would have been patched to hell. And it was still been crap. But you know what? Back in the day, it was just flat out crap. You know? They couldn't try to fix it. It
No,
was
I mean
bad.
that obviously brings up, you know, some of the, you know, the merits of video game patches. And you know, I think there's a point where patches are good on products that are already highly polished. As an
Yes.
example, there is a glitch in the original Twilight Princess where if you save in the cannon room, you lose your save file. You can't get out. You're stuck.
Damn.
That's a pretty big glitch. There's also a glitch in some of the original cartridges for Majora's Mask where if you save right before the boss in the Stone Tower Temple, it deletes your save file.
What? Wow.
Yes. It wasn't on every. It was just some of the early collector's edition cartridges. So it's like, and I happen to have one of those. That's why I know about it. And of course, I did it to myself twice. I don't know
Isn't
why, back to back. So.
Majora's Mask a good example of like a Zelda game that wasn't delayed but instead rushed? And it, you know, it was rushed to hell, and
it was Majora's Mask is obviously a very unique situation, because it used the same engine, the same models, the same everything. So, like, we say it's rushed, but a lot of the work they spend these years doing on was already done for that game.
Yeah, I mean,
all they had to do was come up with a story and some an idea.
For the most part, the game was already being worked on when they switched it over to Majora's Mask, because it was supposed to be an expansion for the disk drive and all that fun
stuff.
And
there was a recent quote where he said that, you know, it took him a year to make Clock Town. Well, probably. I know the game got made in a year. I'm like, yeah, it was mostly made in a year, but a lot of the work was just on Clock Town.
Mm-hmm.
Like, majority of that game is just copying textures and, you know, just setting up dungeons. Like it really, I know, you know, I'm making it sound easier than it really is, but for that particular game, it was easy.
Mm-hmm.
And for that stuff. So it was one of those where, and that's a thing that I've always been critical of Nintendo of, like, you know, Ijinoma said in these previous quotes that, you know, they like to do something new with every game. And that's fine, but, like, there's nothing saying you can't have, like, games using the same art style. Games using the same engine. Like, that's okay to do
that. Well, it's not necessarily just that being the problem. Like, if you look at Metal Gear Solid, that all runs on the same engine, but that's because they refined the engine through time. So the Foxhound engine was being refined over and over and over again.
Yeah.
Whereas Nintendo's kind of like, with the Zelda games, oh, well, we finished that game, let's throw that engine out the window, build a completely new one from scratch,
and that's why the games take so long.
Yeah.
It's like, not just, like, you know, everyone's like, oh, they should just hire more people. I'm like, they could, but ultimately what the problem is that it's basically been a problem under Eiji Onoma where they just scrap everything and start over again. It's mm-hmm. like, why are you doing this? Like, you don't have to. Now, I understand in some cases, like the Wind Waker, they were working on the Wind Waker 2, which I would assume was going to use the same engine and all that stuff. Obviously, that got scrapped for Twilight Princess.
I'm just surprised. Mm-hmm. I'm just surprised, like, Aonuma, you think Aonuma would have control over whether or not the game got delayed. So when I read that article about, like, no.
It's like, nope.
It's like, no. I'm like, really? I'm like, because I've read other developers' reasons for delay.
So what we can say is, we can blame him, but we can't blame him because it wasn't his decision.
Yeah. I mean, it was his fault for delay, but then it wasn't his fault for delay.
Like, it's his fault because he didn't make sure his team could get it done in time, but then it's not his fault. Because he's also, apparently, you know, he's more in a Miyamoto role now, where he's, like, approving of everything in the game. He's not on the ground floor making it. He's described in some of the interviews at E3 where, like, staff were coming to him with stuff, and that's not how he described things in the past. So, you know, I don't think that Ijinomo does a lot of personal development anymore on the games. I think he does do some dialogue stuff. I think he admitted he wrote the dialogue for this game, too. So he does stuff, but he's not on the ground floor anymore. So maybe it's just the whole Shigeru Miyamoto is still there. This is his franchise that he founded. No matter what, he gets final say.
For
better or worse.
Yeah, for better.
Shigeru Miyamoto said he gave Eiji Onoma complete freedom with this game, but Miyamoto still had the say on if it was going to be delayed. And what was weird, too, is they said that this game was originally put on... They made this decision to put it on the NX 2 years ago, which was around the time they unveiled this game in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes me wonder if they planned it to be, like, a 2015 Wii U release and then a 2016 NX, like, remastering release, like some other companies have done. Makes me curious if, like, that was the original plan or if they thought the NX was coming out sooner, or if they just are really, really bad with math and time and don't realize that 2 years ago they first announced it. And
it's the Japanese calendar is completely different than ours, so that's their excuse.
I know. the whole thing's interesting. Anyway, we ran out of time a long time ago, but this was a really good topic, so I didn't want to.
It's really a poor excuse.
Not have us get things. We spent way too much time on that first topic, which is. Anyway, so we're going to move into our fan topics. And if we have a little time left in the timer, we'll hop back to maybe get to my last topic I have here. But probably not because we still have the bets to go. So I got the timer going, 15 minutes, talk about some fan topics. I'm going to go to Twitter first since Twitter got ignored last time. And I really apologize to our Twitter followers about that. So Pat Magroin, he says, will Skyward Sword be remade in 4K for the NX?
No.
Well, obviously, we don't know.
Oh, yeah. We don't know.
First off, we don't even know if the NX is going to output at 4K. We don't even know that much.
I don't think it will.
Yeah.
I don't think it will either.
I could see it doing 4K streaming. Like streaming Netflix in 4K. I could see it that. Beefy enough to actually... Because, like, it's not that beefy to do that. Like, little Roku $50 devices do
it. And before we started this podcast, I showed Alfred that, like, somebody already took Skyward Sword and, like, fully HD'd it for, like, the newest Dolphin emulator. So, I can...
That was done, like, the day it was released.
Yeah, see? That's old. So I can easily see it getting emulated, if somebody hacks the NX software, which I know is probably going to be possible. So, they can easily just make their own HD version off the NX system. So, it's not a no, but then again, I don't think we're getting in 4K, though.
The issue I have with this question, we've had a similar question come up before. What's going to be the next remake game? And I argued with Darren, telling him that, because he said Skyward Sword, and I said, it's not happening. The big caveat with Skyward Sword isn't even the 4K. It's, does the NX support Wiimotes?
Yeah.
That's true.
Because, to be honest, they said that this was not a Wii or a Wii U replacement. It's something entirely new. And that means that, to me anyways, that they want to ditch that Wii brand. They're going for a rebranding again.
And they really need to.
Wii U has tanked their brand for Wii. And Wii died out so long ago. So, my thing is, I don't think they're going to support it. They might support the Pro Controller. Maybe even game pads for some reason.
But I
do not see them being like, you know what, you can bring those Wiimotes from two gens. Why don't you bring them on over?
I would like them to do like what Capcom did with the Resident Evil Remaster HD and bring Ocarina of Time 3D to like the Wii U and NX. I would really enjoy that if I had to choose.
I actually said this before. The next HD remake they're going to do is going to be Ocarina of Time.
Yeah.
Yeah, so...
Because it's not in HD yet, and it's going to... They already proved with the 3D remake it's going to sell.
Yeah.
And it fits standard controls, so if like there's a more standard control setup again, it makes a lot of sense for the NX.
I can see...
Well, it looks like Nintendo's...
Skyward Sword's window was this year, and they didn't announce it, so we're not getting it.
It looks like Nintendo's putting a lot more faith in Grezzo as a company.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like, they're doing that new RPG anyways... So yep. I don't think it would be too out of the realm of possibilities to see them go ahead and just take Ocarina of Time and create a completely, like, I don't know if new models, new textures for it, to complete HD remix. Using Final Fantasy terms there.
Yeah, I don't see him. See him doing that. I see them just like HD'ing the 3D version. Honestly, that's all. Yep. That's all I see him doing.
Okay, so to answer your question, Pat. Skyward Sword's probably not getting done at all.
No.
Let alone in 4K on the NX. Liam O'Leary, or @shadow7557 on Twitter, he wants to know everyone's favorite and least favorite weapon/item from the series.
Oh, okay.
So, Kristen, you go first.
Are we talking main series or even, like, spin-off handheld titles?
Those aren't spin-offs. Those are part of the main series.
But... The handheld titles.
You just answered your own question. They're part of the main series, so yes, they count.
Oh, this is difficult.
I can't believe... Like, I'm so insulted you just called this.
I know. You always do that.
Oh, my God.
I
like, that's
say
what
that.
Zelda was before Ocarina of Time. Come on.
This is difficult, because right. I've been having to play a lot of Ocarina of Time lately, and one of my favorite games is the Wind Waker. So, like, it's really
this
difficult.
Is all just for weapon and item from the whole series.
Favorite weapon or item and least favorite weapon or item. Okay.
Yep. Favorite and least favorite. Oh. Yep.
Frick, this is going to be difficult. As of right now, I don't think I have an all-time favorite, but as of right now, because of the Ocarina of Time, possibly, I think my favorite weapon right now is the Biggeron sword.
Okay,
that's honestly...
That's fine. Okay, what's your least?
Least favorite... Oh, god damn it. There's so much... No, wait, scratch that. My favorite item, I just thought of it, because my Wind Waker is my favorite game. No, my favorite... is the Swift Sail from HD. And, no, because that that helps out so much.
That's fine. What's your least, though?
Least, I don't...
We got two favorites, so I need a least here.
I don't know least. You know, there's been no one item to truly piss me off. That's the problem. Right. No.
Alfred, save him.
Okay,
what's your least favorite item?
Least favorite item, and You know I love this game, Nate. You know Majora's Mask is my favorite Zelda game. But I hate the Goron Mask. And here's why. Because
so disappointed.
One of the ways to get one of the bottles is in that freaking Goron race where you have to, like, that's also part of the way to get the Razor Sword, and I hate that race. Gave me so much trouble. And then I hate
that race is difficult.
The boss of Snowhead Temple because it's like exactly like that race. And it's just
I love that boss.
I love the fact, like, I love the item. It's great for, you know, going around places fast, but it just the way it's used, it just I hate it.
What's your favorite?
Favorite item is it's between okay, it's not between anything. I really like the Rock's Feather from Four Swords Adventures.
Okay.
Because that's like one of the first times
choice.
We got to jump in a Zelda game, and it was used
Link's
pretty well.
Link's Awakening was the first time
to jump. But I liked how it was used. I said the Rock's Feather in general is one of my favorite items because it allowed us to jump. It allowed us to get to places that we couldn't get, even though there were still some really weird restrictions on it, like you couldn't jump over certain ledges or whatever. But it was used pretty well in the game, and I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I think it was a great item for, you know, the top-down Zelda game.
Sure. My favorite item would be, well, you know what? Let's go with least favorite because I'm in a unique situation. I played Breath of the Wild, and there's not really a lot of items I dislike in Zelda. You know, there's ones that I wish had more uses, like the spinner, ball and chain.
That's where mindset.
But the thing is, I actually like those items. I just wish they did more with them. I keep thinking, you know, what items annoy me? What items don't I like? And to be honest, I think tree branch sticks in Breath of the Wild. Not because they're like, I'm glad they exist because it makes the world more believable. It makes sense. You know, yeah, you hit a tree, sticks are going to fall. That's what happens when I go outside. Well,
when you punch
not,
a
hit
tree,
it with my body. I hit it with my body, I just fall to the ground. The tree takes me out.
I'm just imagining you rolling into a tree.
But, like, it's so useless. It breaks after, like, one or two swings. It does, like, no damage to anything. Yes, you can light it on fire. Which, again, you can use it like a torch, so you can light enemies on fire, you can light grass on fire, so it has a use. But so does every other wood item in the game, and all the other wood items, one, the torches hold fire the longest. Who knew a torch is actually better at holding fire than a stick that burns up right away?
Oh, okay. Nate brought it up, and I just realized when it comes to uselessness, I think my least favorite item is Saria's Ocarina from Ocarina of Time, because how useless it pretty much becomes after you get the Ocarina of Time.
That's sad. That's sad. That's such an emotional item.
I know.
It's such an emotional item, but then it's
you
also
bastard.
The most pointless item.
You bastard.
it is. It's like,
anyway,
ooh, I could...
Okay, you keep changing your item the more we talk. So let me get through mine. So that's my least favorite so far. Just because functionality-wise, there's things that do it all better. And it'd be different if, like, you had to pick up the stick and it had to be your first weapon. Like, okay, I get it because how that game works. But it's not. There's an axe you can go pick up. You don't have to use that right away. So that's my least favorite just in terms of functionality. I like that it's in the game, but I don't really – I think it's pointless. I think you should be able to use it as firewood. That would have made more sense to me. My favorite item. This is hard because – the cop-out is saying the Fierce Deity Mask.
Yeah, I mean, that's what
I had
to
like
refrain
that.
From saying.
You become a badass, you get, you know, the ultimate laser shooting sword, yada, yada, yada. You know, obviously like a Master Sword or a Hylian Shield. Like, those, you know, those are all, to me those feel like cop-outs, because like those are the obvious answers.
Where?
You know, anyone, even the Razor Sword, just how cool it looks, like it feels like a cop-out.
I know what your favorite item is. The Great Fairy Mask.
No. No. My favorite item is, what are those, I think it's a Minish Cap, those mitts you get that you can dig into the ground.
Oh, the digging mitts, the digging claws?
Yeah,
the
whatever.
Mole
mitts. I think they've been in multiple, I think they've been in two different games too. Whatever that item's called, which sucks, I can't remember it because it's my favorite item and I can't remember it. But that whole mechanic and the use of those, I loved it. That was like one of my favorite moments in a top-down Zelda.
Yeah, they're called the Molemits.
The Molemits, yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, those are so cool. And that's, I mean, that's probably my favorite. I mean, I'm just thinking through all the items in the series. There's so many good ones. There's so many magic ones I love. But, man, I just love what the Molemits do. It's amazing. So that's my favorite. So I think that's all of us. So we'll see how many more tops we can get. We've got 4 minutes on the clock here. Jake T. Apodaca from our Twitter, he asks, Link's Awakening nostalgia and the idea of a remake. With the Marin DLC coming out, it sounds like that would be a good topic to talk about.
Didn't we already talk about remakes already?
We did. We did a little bit. I mean, technically the question wasn't about remakes, it was about one game.
I mean, don't get me wrong.
It became more.
Don't get me wrong, Marin looks pretty badass in Legends.
Oh, Marin looks amazing.
I love that the windfish is in that game now.
She kicks your butt with a bell. She kicks your butt with a bell. I mean.
Oh, yeah. But, like, the Link's Awakening nostalgia is awesome, because Link's Awakening is... I think Link's Awakening is actually my favorite handheld game. Thinking of my rankings, yeah. I think it's my favorite.
Get behind that. Right.
It's so amazing. You could jump in the game. Obviously, you could jump in Zelda 2. So Zelda 2 was the first game to have jump. But Link's Awakening for top-down games was the first game you could jump. I'm sorry, I had to bring that up again after your previous.
It's
comment.
Okay. I completely forgot that item was in.
I was like, there's actually been two prior Zelda games before that you could jump in.
Yeah.
And both of those happen to be among my favorite games in the series.
I completely forgot it
apparently
was in those
jumping's
games.
The key. If Breath of the Wild jumps up into my top three, it's because you can jump, people. I just noticed that. Zelda 2 is my favorite. Link's Awakening is number 2. So they both can jump.
To answer the question, I would like to see... I wouldn't mind seeing a Link's Awakening HD. Like, for 3DS, but, you know...
Like, well, the whole idea, like, a Link's Awakening, like, a remake, I always think, what kind of remake are we talking about? Because if we're talking about, like, into a full 3D game...
I'd see it in the
style.
That's
like a whole topic on its own. Like, should we remaster 2D Zelda games into 3D world? Because everything in those games is designed to be top-down. So, like, those puzzles don't necessarily translate into a 3D world. So, like, there'd have to be so much redone, it might not even feel like Link's Awakening.
It would probably end up looking something like a Link Between Worlds.
Link Between Worlds is probably the closest you could get. And then I'm like, do I really want it that way? They gave us Link's Awakening DX, so they already technically remade it one time. To give it color, they added a new dungeon to it, fixed a few bugs.
Yes. DX.
So they kind of already remade it once. You know, I wouldn't mind seeing it maybe one more time and having things smoothed out, so maybe it's not as pixelated. Mm-hmm. But I don't really want the art style to change. Like, you know, to me, A Link Between Worlds, while it is the world of A Link to the Past, the art style doesn't feel the same to me.
Yeah.
So I almost wouldn't even want, like, A Link to the Past remade in that style. So, like, Link's Awakening, I kind of wanted to... If they could smooth out everything but have it be the same art direction, that would be amazing to me.
Yeah.
And that art direction can't be that difficult since it's Mario.
Pretty much.
So, like, it really shouldn't be that hard to maintain that. Nintendo makes a lot of Mario games. I think they know what they're doing.
I'm just worried that were they to remake that... First off, I don't think that they would. If they remade it... top-down game, it would be A Link to the Past.
Sure.
But I'd like to see a more updated version like you, Nate.
Yep.
And, I mean, that could be a possibility with Marin in Hyrule Warriors Legends, Warriors. I'm just worried that they would make it too much like A Link Between Worlds, because that seems to be their go-to style for top-down Zelda games now. Like, Triforce Heroes looks like it.
How would you like to see
I'll get into that another day. But I don't really think that's their go-to style.
Well, I mean, for the past two handheld Zelda games, it's been...
Yeah, but there's a reason that Triforce Heroes went that way. There's actually an interview that states that Link Between Worlds was actually not the original art style.
But
we can get more into that later, because one of the topics that I wanted to talk about today had to do with multiplayer Zelda games. But we will get into that next time. That'll be our lead topic. I'll jot that down right now. Unless we get blasted with big news, that'll be our lead topic. So the timer's just about to go off. I just want to see answer a couple things here that I see on our Facebook page quick. Like Joshua Copeland, he asks, when will Nintendo reveal the NX? All we can tell you is fall.
Yep.
Yeah, there's sources saying fall.
So think Think September through November, somewhere in there.
I'd say probably August. August to November.
August to summer.
I'd say November. I still say November.
Nintendo literally said fall, and August is part of summer. So September is the start of fall.
Okay.
So September, October, somewhere in there. I don't think they're going to do it in November because there's like Black Friday and too much other crazy stuff going on. But I can see them going hardcore with that stuff in September and October to get it out of the way so they can advertise the few holiday games they do have, such as Pokemon.
Yeah, that's true.
Ben Williams, he wanted us to talk about NX specs. There's nothing to talk about.
Last thing we heard was that it was going to probably be as powerful as like the Xbox One, but that's really it.
Well, the last thing we heard is that Nintendo doesn't care about specs. So, yeah. And we talked about that last week. So we don't really have anything to add to the Nintendo spec talk until we get new information. And right now we don't have any new information. We don't even have new rumors. We have nothing new to go off of.
Let's come up with
what
some
we talked
new
about
rumors.
Last week. Yeah, we make up our own. This kind of goes along with the Hyrule Warriors thing quick. We'll just kind of mention this in there. Stacey Lynn says, let's talk about Marin having the power to drop magical whales on people in Hyrule Warriors and how that is the greatest power ever. By the way, it's not just any magical whale.
It's the great windfish.
It is probably the most important whale in the series.
Yeah.
I mean, there's one in Skyward Sword.
It's
and
probably
you know,
one of the most important whales
There's speculation that those
time.
Are the same whale, but...
a big whale.
It is awesome. It is probably one of the coolest powers I've seen. And Hyrule Warriors has so many cool, good ones.
I like how Link will also become Bruce Lee with her new weapon.
Yep. And just a shout out to Mitchell Cote. Because of my little post on Facebook asking for stuff, he discovered the podcast for his first time today. So
yay.
Awesome.
Congrats.
Thanks, man. We're hoping to gain new fans every week, every day. Enjoy. So... we get to move on to the final part, the betting results.
Ooh.
So if you guys don't care about the bets, you can tune out right now because this is all it is to the end of the podcast.
For those who are interested and who don't know about it, could you explain it to me?
Okay. So.
All right, Alfred, it's on you. I'm starting the timer, so this is all part of it.
Okay. When we're going to do the pre-E3 podcast, Nate and I decided to come up with a few bets that may or may not happen, and we like things that may or may not happen during E3, and we gave them to Rabbit Luigi or Darren and had them say yes or no. And based on their answers, that was what was going to be judged on. To be fair, Nate didn't really give me a lot of parameters for bets. So
it's okay, there'll be more next time.
Some of the questions may or may not be a little crazy or a little too easy. But I think
okay.
that I did a good job.
It's okay. I did a very good job. I was very surprised, actually. But we're not into the results yet. So obviously it wouldn't be a bet if there wasn't stakes. So for those who don't know, if I lose, I have to dress up as Tingle and act like Tingle on an episode of The Boss Man. The funny thing is that Tingle is, you know, like a 30-year-old guy who thinks he's a fairy. I turned 30 in like a week.
Oh my god.
And Tingle's one of my favorite characters in the game. So I kind of already am him, so this is going to be very...
That will be the best day
ever. I think it's going to be bad if I lose. If Alfred loses, he has to also dress up as Tingle. And remember, this is as much as... we say as much as you reasonably can. I don't expect either one of us to go out and spend a lot of money on...
So either way, I'm grabbing a bag of popcorn.
Although Darren
did
say if I lost, he would buy me green tights. So that's scary. Anyways, I was really hoping to get away with the tights because I don't have green tights. But Darren's not going to let
me
get away with
it. So whoever loses, I win. So I get to sit there with a bag of popcorn
wins.
Going.
I don't know. I don't know. Me and green tights might not be a win for anyone.
Yeah, I can.
Anyways, Alfred, if Alfred loses, he's got to dress up as Tingle and record a video of himself saying Kula Limpa as someone splashes his face with cherry Kool-Aid.
I like how you
either way, it'll be hilarious.
Flavor.
Obviously,
he gets off the easiest. What the heck?
Because I was the one that put up the bet first, so of course he came at me harder.
To be fair.
And the funny thing is, I have... I hope this ends in a tie. All right, let's get to the results here, okay? So for those who don't know, if someone got a question right, That is 1 point for the person who asked the question. If they got it wrong, that is 1 point for the opponent. So we'll start off because Alfred asked the first question. He said, and he asked Rabid Luigi, will Nintendo say, look forward for more exciting content in months to come?
Oh, that was a gimme. Rabid, are you kidding me?
Well, here's the thing. Rabid Luigi said yes. So, obviously I was at E3, so I didn't get to watch all the coverage. So, the last 3 days, I went back and watched all of Nintendo's live stream.
Oh.
All of it.
And they didn't say it at all.
They did not say
really?
It.
Really?
They didn't.
They did not.
Damn.
I thought that this is the key. I really needed him to get this one wrong, because I thought for sure they said it. I'm like, they had to have said it at some point. But you know why? Because they didn't keep Reggie on there. Reggie's the one who always
said it.
But he didn't say it. So we started off, first question asked, that's a point for me.
Oh, damn. I actually...
Already up 1-0. And for, in the video, I'll put up a little score counter so people can keep track a little easier than me always having to remind you. So then my question, I asked Rabid Luigi, will Nintendo unveil a new game during their live stream?
I hate you so much.
Oh, come on.
He said no.
Oh,
I thought
right.
It was going to be a yes, but he said no.
Are you kidding me? That's,
what do you think that answer is?
That's right. The point goes to me.
Yeah.
Yes.
They confirmed it like a week before the E3. Like, oh, by the way, we are still showing other games during our presentation. They
didn't say new games, though. They just said
what was
other
the
games.
New game? What was the new game, Alfred?
It was that RPG by Grezzo. Or Mario Party Island, whatever the new Mario Party game is. Star Rush. There you go.
Star Rush. Yep. Now, I was looking at it because technically I knew about these games before it happened, but it was like it came out like the same day. So I'm counting it. That is a point for Alfred.
One. All right.
So we're tied up 1-1. All right. So Alfred, he asked Darren, will Nintendo announce the date of their next Nintendo Direct? Obviously a silly question. Darren said no. That was 100% correct. That is now 2 points for Alfred, 1 for Nate.
Nintendo,
very upset.
Yeah, Nintendo's like, are you kidding me
upsetting.
Right now? It's like, look how much you're
very
showing right
upsetting.
Now. Oh, you want another Direct already?
So here's a cool one that I won on a technicality.
Oh.
I asked Darren, will Nintendo say open world over or under 15
times?
Nintendo did say open world like twice. They reworded open world to
open
air. Because they don't want to be associated with open world games.
Oh.
So, because, and they said open air, I lost count after like 17. But it doesn't matter, because I said open world. And Nintendo decided not to do it. I thought that was a for sure loss. That became a victory for me. Thank you, Darren. Because they only said it twice.
Oh, man.
All right. I got very lucky on that one.
You did.
Even with the open air, I thought they still said it more often than they did. But they really stuck to that open air term. So this is one that we might have a little debate about. This is a question from Alfred. That he asked Rabbit Luigi, and it had three possible answers. It said, will Square Enix show off Final Fantasy VII, Sony, or will both of them?
Uh-huh.
Rabbit Luigi said both. Now, this is one that I want to have a further conversation on, because technically Square Enix didn't have a press conference.
Yeah.
So, well, they had a live stream event like Nintendo. And of course, in a live stream event, they're going to show it off. I mean, they were there all of E3 streaming. So, they didn't show it off. They showed off the demo, the same demo they had on the show floor.
But he said both, so I'd lose that one.
Yeah, and he said both. So, it's one of those that I think it's a loss. Just because Square Enix didn't have a press conference. So...
I mean, like, they still showed it off during E3, but if Sony didn't show it off, then I lose.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
He said both, and they did not show off, surprisingly, any new...
I thought for sure they were going to.
The closest thing to a set.
To Sony's credit, they had some other big announcements.
The closest thing to a 7 they did actually show was Resident
Evil
7.
So that's what I was
going to
say. So, you know, there was a technicality. Square Enix showed it off, but it really wasn't a press conference. But Sony didn't. So that is point for Nate.
Yep.
I'm now in the lead 3-2. This is intense.
I know.
This is a lot tighter, I think, than Alfred thought it was going to be.
Yeah.
All right. So, this one. I asked Rabid Luigi, will there be over or under 250 posts made at Zelda Informer between Tuesday and Thursday during E3 week?
Oh, man, I didn't even E3 count.
Rabid Luigi said under. He was correct. There was 228, and that counts the posts I made. So I'm even breaking my own rules and counting my posts in just because I didn't want to eliminate them because it was under. That's a victory for Nate. Score is 4-2. It's turned into a slaughter, Alfred.
I know it is.
It's okay. Here's where you're going to get one back. Here's where it's coming. This is probably the stupidest... Well, no, this is the second stupidest question he asked. Do you think the reception for Zelda U will be positive or negative? And he clarified that this is from the media, not from fans. Because, you know, I could argue gender stuff is negative, I guess. But, yes, Darren. Darren said positive. The awards are still piling up for the game, so that is correct. Hmm. Like, almost every major outlet gave Zelda some sort of award for being awesome.
Yeah, pretty much the majority has been Game of the Show and Coolest Booth.
Yeah. Yeah, and if it didn't get Game of the Show, or if it didn't get Coolest Booth, because Mafia 3 also had a really awesome booth.
Yeah.
It was still, like, right there at the top, like, number two if it didn't get number one. All right, so now the score is Alfred 3, Nate 4.
Ooh. It's not like it helped me any. You're still in the lead.
Yeah, but only by one.
Yeah. Only and if you one. Tie, who knows?
All right. This one bit me in the butt. This one I'm upset about.
If this is the one I think it is, then yeah.
I asked Darren if Aisha Tyler would sit in the crowd during the Ubisoft press conference. I thought for sure she did. She's done it in half the other ones she's been in. She did not. She sat on stage several times. Aisha Tyler, you screwed me. Because Darren said yes. We are tied.
Yeah, you should have made it to where, like you said, like other people were helping host.
I should have just said, is she going to sit down? I should have just said, is she going to sit down? I knew she was going to sit down, but I said in the crowd.
Oh, yeah. Well, you'll remember that for next year. She hosts again. Just say that.
The problem is she does something different every year. She does. But half of her appearances in the past, she went and sat in the crowd. I should have just went with a general sit down, especially with how the questions were going up to this point. But I didn't. I stuck to my guns because that was originally what I wrote down. But so wait, we are tied. We are tied. This sucks. We are totally tied. This next question was the stupidest one.
It was voted out.
Fans did vote this question out. It doesn't matter. Either way, you're getting a point here. Okay, so the original question was, do you think that Half-Life 3 will be announced as an NX exclusive? He asked Darren that. Darren said no. Obviously, Half-Life 3 wasn't even announced, so it was obviously not an NX exclusive. It was a guaranteed point question. And I thought it was cheating, even though we didn't have any rules to say it was cheating, so it really wasn't. But the fans literally voted it out. It was a pretty heavy against.
Yeah.
That's a bullshit question and shouldn't count.
I'm sorry. It's Half-Life 3. It's, come on.
Yeah, like, it was a stupid, like, and not to, it's one thing for him to say, do you think Half-Life 3 will be announced? But an NX exclusive, that's the part that got
me. To be fair, I did ask Nate, can I have a stupid
question?
And he said yes.
It didn't break the rules. I just couldn't believe he had the balls to even bring that question to the table. However, this is what he replaced it with. The substitute question was, do you think that Nintendo is going to talk more or mention the newer roles for Miyamoto or Reggie? He asked this for Rabbit Luigi. He said no. He was correct. I made sure I went through to see the introductions because the only really hope I had was that it was going to pop up on the screen. Never popped up on the screen. No surprise because right now, as we're recording, those positions don't exist yet. They're being voted on right now.
See, I didn't know that when I made that question.
Yeah. So it was almost, but like, it was either I allow that one or I allow Half-Life 3. So, I mean, I took a shot. Either way, he gets a point. Alfred is now in the lead, 5-4. Oh, boy. This is so intense. All right. So, I asked Rabid Luigi, will Sony announce a PlayStation Slim edition at E3?
Oh,
he said yes. I understand why he said yes. We knew Xbox was doing it. Figured maybe Sony has something to respond. That was a no.
Yeah. Yeah, the closest thing they confirmed was like, yeah, we have it, but we're not showing anything right now.
So about that crush he now is doing. Alfred is now up 6-4. So I can only hope for a tie at this point. One more wrong, one more point for him, it's over. It's all over. The fat lady sings. But let's get to your last question here. You asked Rabbit Luigi, will Sony's project with Kojima Productions be a new or spiritual successor? He said completely new. He went back and forth because he's like, it's going to be completely new and it's going to be a spiritual successor. But we settled on, he said completely new.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah.
So here's the question with this one. And this is what I was sure, because I went back and watched the reveal. Because, you know, it was revealed, everyone saw it. You know, Norman Reedus, that's pretty much all we know about it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we actually know if it's completely new or if there's a successor.
He did say before the trailer started that it was remade for you.
Yes.
What he said later on in an interview was that when he made Metal Gear Solid, there wasn't such a thing as a stealth action game. And then mm-hmm. later on in the interview, he said, and just like with Metal Gear Solid, I'm looking to redefine video games, and Death Stranding, I don't remember what he called it, is a completely new video game genre that you've never seen before. So at that point, I think it would be considered a new game.
Yeah,
like,
true.
Well,
it was always a new game.
I know, but we always knew
it was a new game.
Not spiritual successor.
The only reason I'm arguing this one, is because we didn't see the game.
That's true.
We saw a teaser. We don't know what this game is. Like, you know, this genre, you know, didn't exist. It doesn't mean that it's not inspired by it. That's my kind of my counter argument, because I went through, I watched the press conference, I watched the stuff. I didn't know about that interview, that quote. That's obviously some new information.
Mm-hmm.
But still, no one knows what this game is. So how can we say what it is?
Okay.
Unless he specifically came out and he was like, it does not have any inspiration from Metal Gear Solid at all.
Here's what, in an interview with Games...
That's my argument for it. Because this is a big point. I need this point, so I'm going to argue this till...
With Games Radar, he said, we finally know what Hideo Kojima's new game is called, Death Stranding.
Sure.
That it will star a space prisoner played by Norman Reedus, and that it's very close to entering full production.
A space prisoner.
Yeah.
Yep.
And then but the problem is, and this is where I could see Nate kind of looking at it and being like, he said it will feel very familiar, but after an hour or two of playing, you will start to feel something different, something new that you haven't played. The story is about connections, what you call strands in psychology, and how people are connected.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, my problem is that, one, we didn't see the game. So, we're going off of interviews.
Mm-hmm.
Two, in the interviews, he even admitted it's going to feel familiar. Even though it's got new concepts, obviously, I mean, it's not going to be literally Metal Gear Solid. I don't think either one of us thought that was the case.
No.
Because he can't. I mean, he could, but, you know, it was never going to be literally Metal Gear Solid. That's my thing. I don't think we know enough to give anything for this.
Okay.
If that makes sense. Like, that's kind of my argument right there. Like, we just don't know enough.
I'm okay with tossing that question out then.
Well, here's the problem with the toss out on that.
I know. You
technically, I mean, it's incorrect and I get a point.
Yeah. Well, but the problem...
So yeah. I didn't want to, like, make this decision because it benefits me, and obviously I really need this point. But I'm just like, man, I went through all this stuff, and I'm like, I don't know what this is. No one can tell me what this is because nobody knows. They didn't. I wish they would have shown an actual gameplay with it. That would have helped.
Mm-hmm.
That would have really helped. Because, like, if it showed some stealth, and I would have been like, oh, Metal Gear Solid inspired. Or it didn't, and it just showed stuff I've never seen in my life. Okay, then not. It's just, I don't know. I don't know what to say. Kojima doesn't know what to say, that bastard.
Kojima has always been cryptic about his
games. He's so cryptic about everything.
See, here's,
that's what makes his games get so hyped.
And see, here's the problem, because I'm reading the Wired interview, and it's like, so they asked, so it's a multiplayer game. It's like, well, it's not so simple. It's a new system. And I'm like, okay.
Oh, no. I remember I read GameSpot's interview with him, and he's telling, oh, it's kind of like action RPG-ish. I'm like, okay, then what about those other interviews I heard where you don't really know the genre? Make up your mind.
That's what I'm saying. He is so cryptic. I just can't base it I feel like I just can't base it on what he said because I don't know what he's talking about. All I can be like, okay, we got a little tease, and the tease basically just told you it's
Norman
Reedus.
Here's something that can kind of answer that. And this is the best thing that I can give you. It says, is it liberating being separated from Metal Gear, not having to make another one, or are you sad you can't make another? He replied, at Konami I had ideas for other games, but Metal Gear was the priority. However, being able to work on something new is a nice feeling.
There.
Yeah, that doesn't matter.
I think that's the closest...
That just means he's not tied. He's just not tied to the Metal Gear franchise anymore. Doesn't mean he's not going to be like inspired by it.
Yeah.
Because like, we haven't seen him make it like really anything else.
But that's...
Yeah.
So how do we know he's not just going to...
Yeah.
Be inspired. And like, how do we know he's just not going to take the mechanics that he's done in Metal Gear, have it in the game, and then just do... But like what Breath of the Wild is. Just something totally different that we've never seen before.
But the problem is that we can't say that all things that Kojima has made have been the same.
Well, not all.
In terms of like the way that the games have played, because if you look at PT, that's completely different.
Well, of course. Of course, we never got to see fully what PT was going to become.
Well, and even
again, that's Capcom being dicks. But
yeah, you mean Konami?
I mean, it clearly didn't look like it was going to be like Metal Gear. But
yeah,
you know, when he says, you know, it's going to look familiar or feel familiar, like okay.
So are you dropping?
That's the thing. Like I'm really torn. I don't think we know enough about it. That's my argument. But Alfred has to make the decision because
I would say it's new. I say yes, it's new.
Of course you do.
Oh, don't.
You're not involved in the bet, though. But that's okay.
No, I'm not trying to take sides.
That's why I'm putting it on Alfred, because this... I mean, God, I'm really clawing for this point.
No, I know.
And I'm not trying to act desperate, because I don't know what this game is. So I literally have no idea. Like, I wrote wrong, right, question mark? That's what I have written in my document. Because I can't make a call on it. This sucks. I hate when it's not definitive and I can't make a call. It pisses me off.
And it's...
I'm pretty sure, like, I have written here, like, I'm confident that it's probably completely new, but I don't know that it is. I can't look at you in the face and be like, it's not like that. Because next thing you know, we're going to get a gameplay reveal a year from now, and it's going to look like Metal Gear with Norman Reedus in space.
It's...
Like, I don't know. Like, why does he got to be so damn cryptic?
Try reading his tweets. It's the exact same thing.
It's so bad. Like, it's so cryptic. Then I'm like, is stuff getting lost in translation? What is going on? I don't know. This is why I have to leave it up to you, because it was your question.
See,
you guys don't have
And I know, like, to you, you're thinking completely... You're like me. I think it's going to be completely new. I don't think I can definitively say that based on what we got at
E3. Yeah, and there's my problem is, if I give it to you, then that means that I was wrong with it being completely new, but then, like you said,
it would be the okay. Like if any of the other questions, like say, there's always a third answer to everything. Like when I did the over under 250 posts, if there was 250 posts made, that's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You would have got the point for that. So like, there's always like that third answer that you can't actually say.
Yeah,
you don't think it's gonna happen. And I think that's kind of where this falls into, where we don't know if it's completely new or a spirit. We don't know. That's why I was like, I want to give the point, but then I don't know. Like, I can't tell you what this game is. I don't know. That's where I'm stuck.
And that's...
But I don't know. I've made my argument. I guess it's up to you.
Why I'm saying to...
This was our betting special. We got to agree on that.
There's two things we could do, and it would only prolong this for one of them. We can have people vote on it.
People vote on it.
And then come back and say, hey, yeah, it looks like a completely new game. It doesn't look like
just what
new
we
game.
Need to do to prolong this betting special.
But based
late.
On
okay.
how much they love me, it would probably go in your favor. but then we could always just toss it out or give us both a point. I mean,
I don't like both the point thing, because that means the question didn't matter.
Okay, so here's what happens then. Regardless of what, so if I give you this point, then you're still going to be 1 point behind me, and so that leads
I'm
you
still
up
losing.
To, that leads you up to a tie. And so,
but
if we,
I mean, that's the best I can hope for.
Yeah, if we end up tying, then we have to do something else. Okay.
Yeah, there's more to go if I tie.
So
if
you tie. So I will give it to you on uncertainty as reluctantly as I possibly can.
Reluctantly as you can.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I can't wait to see how people debate this betting special in the comments.
So, I'm going to go ahead and give that to you. Merry Christmas, Nate.
It's locked in on uncertainty, even though probability says it's probably new. There's too much uncertainty.
Happy Chinese New Year to
Kojima, you. Stop. Yeah, whatever. Kojima needs to... I love Kojima, man. I guess thank you, Kojima, for being the way you are. I would have never had a shot at this point if you weren't. anyways. Oh, my argument sank in. That's a big relief for me. Oh, that I'm telling you, that was like the whole game right there. Oh, my God. My heart was beating. So, the final question then I had, it was for Darren. It said, will there be over or under 6 brand new game reveals between the Sony and Microsoft press conference? Darren answered over. I thought he was an idiot.
He was so wrong.
Yeah, there was way over.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
I stopped counting at 8. I know there was more than 8. It was crazy. And obviously, it didn't include indie titles. Like, this was just AAA games. There were so many reveals. I didn't even consider that. Like, I forgot one of your questions was about Kojima's game. Well, that's one reveal. I wasn't even thinking about that at the time. Like, oh, man. But, hey, you know what? He got it right. That's all that matters. That means we are tied.
Yep.
The first ever betting special gets to go into the impossible to perceive beforehand based on Alfred's bullshit question.
and thanks to Kojima's cryptic
and thanks to all the answers I thought were correct being wrong, and Darren and Rabbit Luigi going with the ones that were right for me. So thank you for that. I got a lot more right than I thought I did. That's why I thought I was toast. I wasn't worried if I got 2 or 3 points from you, because I thought I had 5 wrong.
Guys, you guys don't have like a tiebreaker or anything?
Oh, we do. Okay. So that means we get to go into tiebreaker territory. We're not going to do it on this week's episode. But just because we're over time right now. So next week we'll come back with a tiebreaker. We'll get it right out of the way. First segment, we'll go a quick 15-minute segment on a tiebreaker. And here's the big thing that I did mention with what would happen if we had a tiebreaker happening. The stakes will be risen.
Yep, more punishment.
More punishment. So in addition to the original punishment, there is new punishments to go with it. So... that also gives Alfred and I more time to be more used to each other. So I have to think a bit more about how we're gonna. I didn't think this was going to be a tie going in when I was tallying this today. So
I mean, we can still take that point for the Kojima question and give it to me, and you can just lose.
No, it's already locked in. Locked in. So we'll be back next week. Getting the whatever we decide is gonna be the tiebreaker, whether it's gonna be some more bets or. What, we just had to flip a coin or something. I have nothing. One-on-one
Overwatch.
We'll find a way. We'll live stream something.
I will be totally breaker.
The Matt, I know we both have it on PC. God, you're going to destroy me because I barely even play Overwatch. Well, unless somehow we can get on opposite teams and then my team beats you. Yes.
That's just luck, though, at that point.
Well, that's what I rely to win.
No, technicalities. You rely on technicalities.
I do recall. I very much rely on technicalities. All right, that's going to do it for this week's episode of the podcast. So join us next week to see, the end of the betting special and how mean it's going to be and who's going to be doing what. That involves scary tingleness. obviously, we have a couple cool topics already lined up for next week, including talking about, multiplayer games and the fact that AJ Numa wants to make more of them. So we'll get to talk more about... some of that good stuff. I want to thank Kristen for joining us this week.
No problem.
I'm sure he's going to be on future podcasts because he likes talking.
Yes, yes, so. I do.
All right. You guys want to toss out your Twitter handles quick?
I do not have...
If you have.
I do not have a Twitter handle, but if you do want to catch me, you can catch me... of course, on Zelda Informer or future podcasts.
Of course.
And also, me and my bird do a YouTube channel. Have a YouTube channel called Super Reaction Bros. It's a reaction video series where we react to trailers, video games, all that stuff. And we just finished posting up...
all that great
and
stuff.
And we just finished posting up our reactions to things like Breath of the Wild and all the press conferences. So check that out. It's youtube.com/SuperReactionBros.
And...
yes. Go somewhere else for your Zelda content.
Yes, exactly.
I'm just kidding. What's up, Alfred?
And I'm at Full Metal Alfie. That's pretty much exactly how you think it's spelled.
I don't think I've even followed you yet.
I don't think you do either.
I better go fix that. I feel bad. You're my co-host, and I don't know what's going on in your life, man.
A lot of stuff.
No, we do follow each other. I must have followed you out of my suggestions.
Yeah. I post stuff about things.
Yeah, about things.
Yeah.
Just so people know, none of our Twitter handles are associated with the websites. So, like, we might post stuff from the sites there. We might post our own thoughts. None of it represents anything to do with Zelda Informer. As an example, he retweeted Hideo Kojima. Obviously, that's got nothing to do with Zelda Informer.
Now I'm gonna send a very upset tweet to him now.
Stop being so cryptic, you bastard. You could just leave it at completely new. You had to say it's going to feel familiar. Thank you guys for watching. I'm at Nate Jance, by the way, if you guys don't know. NateJanc. Maybe I'll throw the Twitter handles in the video this time. I have no idea. It's been great. It's been fun. Sorry about this extra long cast. We had a lot to go over. Catch you guys in the flip side.
Later.
Adios.